Full name, Frank?
Frank Markey Condie.
Markey? Now, Markey. Where does the Markey come from?
I think it's... I'm not exactly sure. I think my grandmother, her name was Rose Markey. She was Irish. Everybody says it. Condie, what's that? I said, well, there weren't many Condies in Leith, but that way, you know.
Is it... somebody had said it sounds Italian.
I've heard that, and some other place said it was Portuguese, or, I don't know.
Oh, right. Oh, for goodness,
I really don't know, to be honest.
And what year were you born, Frank?
1938.
And where?
Bangor Road. I was brought up in Bangor Road.
Were you born at home or in...
Easterling. Well, Mum never worked. That's a lot of others didn't in these days. My dad was a docker. Up and down. Sometimes you come home early and that, and what they call a duck egg. That's what the expression was. You probably heard it. That's what happened. Hmm. You go out in the morning, 8 o'clock. If you get picked, you get picked. You don't, you come home. Yeah.
Did he have relatives in the docks then? Or?
No, there's no relatives in the docks. Not I know of, anyway. Close shop to a certain extent. Uncle worked there, your brother. You go, it was almost a family connection at one time. Hmm. But I never knew about anything like that.
So that what you say, he at one time he worked in the docks.
Yeah, to give up through ill health.
And what was that? What was?
Well, he was plagued with ulcers all these days. And ended up in a... Eventually I got an operation and then ended up in a parts department. In the fresh air, etc., like things like that. But that was it. No, stomach ulcers.
Stomach, oh, right, okay.
I went to Bonnington Rd School, in primary school. After that, I went to Leith Academy Secondary. I preferred the secondary better for some reason. Right. I don't know what it was. Primary school was okay.
Right. Favourite subjects?
Not really.
No. Oh, no. No, you just couldn't wait to leave.
To a certain extent, yeah. I started off, first job I got was in the paper shop, top of Bangor Road, was Lane's Paper Shop, delivering papers. And I had my name down for the store milk, which was a big waiting list. I was in the paper shop for about 2 weeks, and then I got a call for the Leith Provident. So I had to go and tell Mr. Lane I was leaving. Mm-hmm. And he was not a happy person, which I could understand. So I went to the store, and I was there for 3 years. It was a good place, the store. A lot of my pals were in the store. We got paid 9 shillings a week. We went on strike for a 2 shilling increase.
And this is just young laddies in us that went on strike.
Yeah,
good grief. Yeah. So how many of you were working from there then?
Well, the store, I'm trying to think, there must have been about 15 of us. And Marin was Ballantyne Road, opposite the State Picture House.
Oh, yeah.
Which was the worst run in the store, because it was down a big brae. And tried to get up with a barrow in the winter, and it was all balconies. Not as easy as a tenement. It was good.
And what, that was before you would go to school, was it?
That was at school, at the time, secondary school. So you went and done your milk in the morning, get up about 5 o'clock. You had to go down to really try and get a lamp. It was a candle in these days, and a lamp on the side of your barrow.
Sounds almost Dickensian, actually.
It's correct. But it was a good laugh. Where you collect the milk, it was in Bowling Green Street. That's where you collect your milk in the morning, your barrow. And you went with your book telling all the customer's name. But eventually you got to remember it, you know. And that's where you started from. Because the stables for the store horses was down in Burlington Street, which is just down Bangor Road, off Bangor Road, where the stables were. It took 2.5 hours sometimes, you know. First time I done it, took maybe 3.5 hours. When you leave, and the person that had your job before leaves, you get his book, about 3 years old, so you can imagine, trying to make out the names, etc., you know. That was the longest part. But once you got used to it, and then you start to learn.
And was that 5 or 6 days a week?
It was, I think it was 6, I remember, right. The mornings, yeah.
So you didn't have much time for a lay-in?
No, but it was really good fun it was, believe it or not, you know. Especially where your pals were there, you know.
Yeah. So how old were you when you started at that?
I think I was just going on 13, if I remember right. Before 13. And you just left when you went to school, obviously.
Yeah.
Well, you're still at school.
Yeah.
Until you left school, but that's where it was. So you went and done that in the morning, rushed home, got again, went to school. But it was, as I say, it was good fun.
But winters must have been quite...
Oh, the winters in these days were bad.
Yeah.
Bad, I must admit. Especially going about a barrel, like, you know. Oh, gee, was. But you just got on with it. You had no choice.
Now, you've told me, because we're going to have a bit of music in a minute, which is my Yiddish mama.
Uh-huh.
Now, you actually saw... Who's the artist?
Izzy Bonn.
Izzy Bonn. You actually saw him
just
live.
After the war in Prince Street Gardens. It was my pal's mother took John and took me, I was his best pal, to go and see this Izzy Bonn. It was just first superstar at Seatbelt. In the 80s, he was a big star.
Yeah, Izzy Bonn, absolutely. Star, yeah. So he was obviously Jewish and from London, I think.
London, he was London, right, Jewish. Big man he was. But that was his famous song. Kind of stuck with me, you know.
Things I should be thankful for, I've had a goodly share. And as I sit alone in the comfort of a cozy chair, my fancy sometimes takes me back to an east side tenement, three flights in the rear to where my childhood days were spent. Wasn't much like paradise, but midst the dirt and all, that I fondly call my Yiddish mama. I need her more than ever now. My Yiddish mama, I'd love to kiss that wrinkled brow. I long to hold her hand once more, as in days gone by, and ask her to forgive me for...
Fantastic. Izzy Bonn there with my Yiddish mama, and you would remember the war. You would have some memories of it going on, wouldn't you?
Remember, as I say, remember when the bombs dropped in Largo Place, it, part of the library, fair it was damaged at the back. And I always remember, I think it was about 3 or something, and my mother took me up and my dad, and he blew out windows in Ballantyne Road, and like, I always remember the sirens. No, it was really strange. You know, excitement's the word. You just I don't know. But they weren't frightened,
no,
to be honest with you, for some reason. You think you would have. No, I wasn't frightened. But it was just, I don't know.
Because you would have had the blackouts, wouldn't
blackout,
you?
Blackout, every night you had to put your body thing in the window, you know? Yeah, and the gas mask, of course. You had a gas mask when you were a child.
And you would have taken that to school?
Did school, yeah. I always remember the smell of it. It's horrible. We had a shelter in Bank Road in our back green. But there was one in Taylor Gardens during the war. But we had the one in the back green. You went down there when you heard the siren going, you know, you went down there.
Yeah.
Fortunately, nothing happened to our street. Rationing, that's correct. Up till 53 when rations stopped. And how close the rations stopped in 1949, if I remember right. It was hard, really harsh conditions. Yeah.
The harsh winter of 47, was it?
47, 56 days it lasted, 56. But the summer before it was the hottest, 1946. Right. I can remember that. But the winter was worse for 200 years. Of course, you're no central heating in 80s. It was no hot water, obviously. No bathroom, nothing like that. It was basic. But that was it. Yeah. We were fortunate in our stair. We had inside toilets. Down the bottom of Bangor Road, what they call Block B, their toilets are outside. 4 or 5 families sharing one toilet, you know. It was pretty hard going.
And then when did you leave secondary?
You leave when you're 15.
15. And did you go straight to work?
Yeah.
So you finished on the Friday and started work on the Monday. And what was your first job?
It was what they called in the shipyard. I mean, you're 15. Before you could start your apprenticeship, you were classed as a boy labourer on a wee card. A boy labourer at 15.
And this was where we're sitting now, Henry Robb's.
That's Henry Robb.
So at 5th.
It was a harsh... health and safety was a... never heard it before. I think back on it, you know.
Yeah.
And nothing was like... you had no official tea breaks. Nothing like that. So you had to get your billy can and heat over the riveter's fire. And I mean, here's... it was a manager. Come, you had to just drop everything and run away.
Boom.
You're full, right, yeah. He was a woman. Remember him, Sandy White. Primitive.
Yeah.
Primitive. You had to drop a cheque when you went to the toilet. Your wee cheque for... in the morning when you checked in.
Right.
You took your cheque to the toilet. and it was a turnstile. And you had to put your cheque in. And the man that was there had a nickname which I can't repeat. And that's what you done. You allowed 7.5 minutes. Then that you took a quarter an hour off you, you know, if you were late. And late was the same thing.
Right.
It was 5 to 8, the door opened. But some of the timekeepers were a bit sadistic, the word. Because you used to run for Admiralty Street through to get to the Robb's Gate, and you used to, especially when you're an apprentice, and they see you coming, and they shut the door at the last. And took, you lost a quarter of an hour, the lot, because the wages were terrible. That's what they'd done, a bit of power. But you're a boy labourer.
And what were you doing? What
and sort? I went to apprentice plumber.
And so what did you do as a boy labourer? Everything kind of? Just odd jobs?
Hand the tools, things like that. Go to the store for material, things like that, you know.
So was it at 16 you started as an apprenticeship?
You started from 16 to your 21, yeah. And I went to National Service.
Right. So you stuck out the 5 years as an apprentice.
Yeah.
And was it significantly better being an apprentice plumber? Or?
Well, obviously you've got to be a bit more money. Not much, but you got back. I think back in the conditions were terrible. That was just part of life, like, you know. So it was a good place to work for camaraderie. Oh, it was really, really good. So I met some characters there. I still see the odd one or two. It's funny, through my life, a lot of places you go and you end up, similarly worked in Henry Robb's. It's strange.
Is it really?
We're in Tunisia many years ago. And Liz and I were coming down the stairs we go to dinner. I've got a good memory for faces, I must admit. I looked at her and said, I'm sure that man across there worked in Henry Robb's. I'm going to speak to him. So I went up to him, and here he did. He was a welder, and I still see him now.
Good
grief. He's 90 odds, he stays down the road to me. Till service, I was stationed at Catrick at first for the training. And I sat my night in the candy with my pal, Nanafi. I looked across here with the regular soldiers, so it was different for the National Service. The sergeant's sitting. I said to Jeff, my friend, I'm sure that boy worked in Henry Robb's. I'm going to speak to him. You better not go, Frank. So he goes, I said, excuse me, sergeant. What is it? Did you ever work in Henry Robb's in Leith? He did. Tipper and painter.
Good.
Obviously, ended up as a regular, like, but so I've got good memory for faces. Yeah. Right?
And it intrigues me, being a plumber in a shipyard. What did your job actually involve?
Oh, just fitting pipes, like pipe fitting.
Okay. And that would presumably have to be done, obviously not the early stages, that would be actually constructing the ship, but before any cladding
That's right. Oh, it's like in the bottoms. In the 90s, it was riveting. When you went into the bottom tanks, and you were on your knees all the time, and the riveters are going, it was pretty noisy.
And you wouldn't have been wearing any protective
gear. No protection at all, nothing like that. It's like when you went down wet, you came home wet. There's no facilities washing hands or changing your clothes. Nothing like that. No.
Were you provided with anything? Boots or...?
Nothing. Not a thing in 80s, no. But you just built with it.
Yeah.
That was just accepted it, and that was it. So it was the norm.
Really,
it was the norm.
You know?
But it was a good, as I say, a good place to work, yeah. A lot of my pals worked there, you know.
Because there were quite a lot of... There was electricians.
Well, there was everything. Plumbers, painters, plate orders. Tons of work, different works in there. Yeah.
Yeah.
It was really labour intensified at shipyards.
Yeah.
Because demarcation was on, you know.
Of course.
Couldn't do that because it was your job.
Oh, yeah.
And you couldn't put this on, you know. And when the Japanese came into the market, that's what killed the shipyards in Britain. So you could do 3 jobs, you know.
And presumably they had a bit more automation and stuff.
That's correct.
Like that.
That's right. Yeah.
So we're gonna go to another of your chosen bits of music, which we've mentioned, which is That Old Black Magic, which is by Billy Daniels. Tell us about that, Frank. Why have you chosen that one?
Well, as I say, he was the first coloured singer I've seen
live.
Of course, come from America.
Yeah.
In the 80s, you thought everybody in America was superstars, to a certain extent they were. So we went to see him. And he was really good. And that's why we went back the second night, because he was that good.
And where did you see him?
The old festival there. It's called the Empire Theatre in Nicholson Street.
And you said something about his pianist as well?
His pianist was called Benny Payne. He took part in some of the songs, like, you know.
Fantastic.
Got a wee bit into it.
To That Old Black Magic by Billy Daniels. And then we'll be back with you after that, Frank.
That old black magic has me in its spell. That old black magic that you weave so well. Icy fingers running down my spine. Same old witchcraft when your eyes meet mine.
same old tingle that I feel inside. Then the elevator starts to ride. Down, down, down I go. Round, round I go. Like a leaf that's caught in the tide. I should stay away, but what can I do? I hear your name.
That was Billy Daniels, and that was the 1947 version of That Old Black Magic. So you got out, were you a dancer, Frank?
Yeah, I went to dancing. First dancing in Leith. It was YWCA, which had been Fire Brigade Street.
Oh, yes, yeah.
But everybody said a dub, see? Yeah. That's where they let me dance, was a dub. Oh, right. Then El Dorado, believe it or not, in A-Days, used to go at weekend, holiday weekend, 12 o'clock till 4 in the morning. Wow. Ken McIntosh was a popular one, Oscar Rabin, Sid Phillips, and it was 4 and 6 to go and see them. And who was coming next was Ted Heath, who was the biggest band in Britain. But believe it or not, the price went up an extra 2 shillings.
Oh.
And we all couldn't go.
Oh, no.
Six and six it went up to.
Good.
That's correct, which was nothing now, but 2 shillings. But it was very popular.
Wow.
And the elder had a ton, you know.
Yeah.
And he had they reckon it was the best floor in Edinburgh because it was springy, because that was where the wrestling was. And that was a Monday night thing.
So did you go to that as well?
The wrestling, aye. First big stars I saw, I think it was just after the war, it was really popular. It was two Londoners.
Right.
It was Bert Azzarati and Ray St. Bernard. He was 22 stone, if I remember right. But we used to sneak in the El Dorado.
Did you? How did you do that?
Well, what you done was all the doors to the safety bar. So you just shake the door and the bar would slide along and you would sneak under the... you know? Man, it wasn't even random, wasn't like that.
Nah.
But it was packed every Monday night. But what, in my opinion, what's changed it? They changed it to a Tuesday night. Tuesday night in Leith was an overtime night. Tennis went right down, eventually shut. But that's what the cause it was that.
Now, I remember when the wrestling used to be on the television,
yeah.
You'd always get old women at the front row.
Nah.
Would you get that?
Nah, not much of that in the wrestling. Nah. Not many women went to wrestling in my time. Not many.
So did you dance uptown as well? Did you go uptown?
Only went once, twice to the Pally. Twice. It was never my cup of tea. But people assume right away when I mentioned dancing in Edinburgh, you must have went to the Pally. I said, no, Sendurin's Leith. Was the place to be, especially for Leith.
And what were your dances?
Oh, well, say quick step.
Right.
I wasn't much of a jiver in any days.
No.
Slow dances. And then the dance came along called the creep.
The creep?
The creep. Oh, yeah. Do, 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 that's how you went. Do, 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 do. Stop. And it was, that's when the called moon dancing came in. Instead of hand to hand, it was...
Hugging.
Yep.
Wow.
Well, I'll tell you a wee story. We used to go to when the YW, the dub, moved from Fire Brigade Street to Northport Street School. Mrs. Hepburn was the one that used to run it. I always remember. And she was standing in the middle of the floor when the dancing started. And she was coming up to her, you're dancing, but she turned to say, no mooning. So you take... this is true. When you go... it was Alexander's band. It was at Sendrooms. That was... band
right.
Called Alexander's band. He was a drummer of the band. He was there all the time. Yeah. Having drink wasn't a big problem, no.
No.
I was never a drinker when I was younger, but there wasn't much drink. Some of the girls used to come in with a half bottle in their handbag, you know, like that, because it wasn't allowed. Otherwise, there was no old bouncers, yeah. There used to be a few fights in the sender rooms. Yeah, a few fights. Because at that time in the early 50s, the gangs started to start up. Not like the gangs now. Drape suits. Teddy boys were more an English thing, if it callers. The other gang in Edinburgh, they were top gang in Edinburgh. Boko was the leader. I never knew him, but I heard about him. Boko. The one in Leith was the top one, was the Carlton gang, the Carlton snooker. And you had the Lock End boys, the Jubilee gang was Granton. We were the Bang Road boys. You had an odd skirmish, nothing.
So where did you buy your suit from, Frank?
Oh, I got mine in Burton's, in the Kirgate. But it was Burton's, Hepburn's, John Collier's, 50 Shilling Tailors. Most of them went to Burton's.
Yeah.
All made to measure. It wasn't the peg suits. Made to measure. Well, you see, what they called bumpers.
Bumpers, right, okay.
Black shoe, but no heel.
Oh.
Aye, but...
Oh, right, I see what you mean. Like,
thick, really thick sole.
Like called, the crepe sole ones?
Type things like that. They call them bumpers.
Bumpers, I say, gosh. So we started talking about when rock and roll were coming in, obviously. That's what you're talking about. And we've got your next choice of music we're going to put up is Bill Haley. So did you go along dancing to Bill Haley?
Yes, I played his records. Of course, when the picture came out, Rock Around the Clock, the actual picture, it was all about rock and roll music in the 50s. He was the main thing with it, and that's where the song came from. Because everybody remembers Bill Haley is Rock Around the Clock.
Yeah, yeah.
But I prefer this one.
So we're going to listen to that, and then we'll chat a little bit more.
Yeah.
That was Bill Haley. Yeah. I have to say, I thoroughly enjoyed that. That was a really good rhythm, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was, yeah.
And you were talking a bit about the fact, the makeup of his band, which I didn't realise.
Yeah,
was...
yeah, two drummers. But when you saw them, my God, they're old. Probably in their 30s, which is...
And we were talking there while the record was playing, that in fact, your wife, Liz, that you didn't meet at the dancing.
No.
But Liz was a what?
She went to the ice skating. Well, every day, pals used to meet at the top of Bangor Road, where the old hospital was. Mm. And we worked down the shipyards. And Liz used to pass along for Henson Street, going down to Joseph Ranks. We used to let on it, etc. So one day, I had a bag of pine drops. And she was passing by, and she took one. And after that, we waited on her for 5 years and walked down. And that's how we met.
Wow! So it was a packet of pan drops that brought you together. So did latterly did you go to the dancing together?
No, not really.
No.
Well, socials like, but not the dancing as such. Right. Well, a couple of times at a Cavendish with my pal and his wife, but no, not really. No.
So was she ice skating out at Murrayfield?
Murrayfield, yes.
So she must have been pretty good.
She was a good skater, yeah.
And did you? We're going to have. I presume we'll have some Elvis next. Mm-hmm. Obviously, you wouldn't have seen him in Edinburgh.
No.
Did you see any of his films?
Oh, the early ones.
Yeah.
But his music was under. No, I think my opinion was nobody could sing this song like him. Anybody?
No.
In my opinion, right. I don't know if you've heard it or not, but.
Well, we're going to hear it right now. I'm always up for playing some Elvis, as you say. So this is One Night.
That was banned in America.
Was it?
But a while.
Good grief. Well, I don't suppose there's any reason why it was, although I assume it was about being with somebody one night.
That's correct.
It's Change Days indeed. Let's listen to good old Elvis.
One night with you is what I'm now praying for. The things that we two could plan would make my dreams come true. Just call my name. My love's too strong to hide. Always lived very quiet life. I ain't never did no wrong. Now I know that life without you has been too lonely, too long. One night with you is what I'm now praying for. The things that we two could plan would make my dream come true. Oh, ain't it? My life, I ain't never did no wrong. Now I know the life without you has been too lonely, too long. One night is what I'm
fantastic. Elvis Presley, One Night. Good choice, Frank, because it's not one of his most well-known songs.
That's correct.
And you were saying an interesting fact there about what changed about Elvis.
Yeah, when he went to do his, he could have applied to go into the entertainment side of it. I've read about all this. But Tom Parker, who was a very clever man. Yeah. No. This is showing patriotism.
Oh, right.
Germany was stationed, yeah.
And you said there was quite a change after he came out.
Yeah, different altogether. It was the Frank Sinatra show, was his first show. He came out in a tuxedo.
You know? Yeah, it's wrong, isn't it? It was wrong. Completely wrong.
But his voice was still great. The song he sang was terrific. And Sinatra, at one time in the 50s, swore he would never have him.
Is that
he's
right?
Not got elastic set on this stuff. So was that Ed Sullivan.
Right.
He wouldn't have him on his show, but public demanded it. That's why he got him on. Especially when you're younger, 4 days a week sometimes, you know. But it was cheap entertainment. There was a State Picture House, which is my local, Palace, the Laurie Street off the Kirrgate, the Capitol, Palace, and, as I said, and the Alhambra.
Which is just a bit further up.
Further up the walk, yeah.
Did you ever go to the Gaiety in...
Went to Gaiety regularly, yeah.
Right, because that was Variety.
Variety show. First, can remember the first turn I saw there, an act called Tommy Hope and Stella Peters. They were that top liners.
Right.
Way back in the early 40s. And after the Warwick was hanged. And then Lex McLean was the next big turn.
He played there quite a bit, didn't he?
He played quite a bit, yeah.
So what were the first couple that you were talking about? What sort of act did they do?
It's a comedy act-like thing.
Right. You did get Variety, that was the thing.
It was a variety bubble you got, that's correct, yeah.
Now, some people talk about they had a mammoth piano playing.
Musical Marie was her name.
Oh.
She was the last act in the Gaiety, if I remember right. 24-hour marathon piano. Obviously, had to stop for... Musical Marie, that was her name.
Is that right? Great, I don't think I've ever heard anyone say her name.
Big lady she was, yeah.
Right. So did you go down there and look at her?
I looked at her, yeah. Just for novelty's sake. But
And it was quite, the seating was quite hard in the Gaiety Theatre, wasn't it?
The balcony was wooden seats. Cheaps, obviously. Any place you go to the film, balcony's always a cheap.
Yeah.
You just put up, that was it.
And did you ever, because the Capital Cinema had a children's club, didn't it?
The Cappy Club, every Saturday morning. as a serial Flash Gordon. Everybody went to the Cappy Club.
Be high excitement.
Yeah,
that
that's
morning.
Great.
So would you all come out playing whatever the film had
that's
been?
Right. Yeah, yeah. Yeah. Cowboys, you come out being a cowboy. We went to the Pool Synod Hall. I don't know if you know this or not, but in the Pool Synod Hall, you were seated on both sides of the screen. So one side you were sitting looking left, the other side you were facing right.
It's quite bizarre.
And people in the middle. So you were sitting like this watching the picture. No, that's just true. Pool Synod Hall. We went to the New Victoria Picture House. And another strange thing was the New Victoria, which is closed now.
Yeah.
Smoking ban. One side of cinema, there's no smoking. Can you just imagine that? The government that went to, that was burnt in the fire. There's a news theatre in the Prison Street, the JC Theatre called it. And Monsignor, the same thing, like, yeah. Went there, same news. And he did it. When young, you tended not to venture much out of Leith. That's right. I mean, five picture houses, you know. It was, well, it changed twice a week. The strange thing was, in the 80s, a new picture came out. It took about 2 months to come up from London to Scotland. Correct, yeah. It took a long time to come up. But there again, when you think about it, 6 months to get in the pictures. And you go, what? Well, big picture, as they call it. A wee picture. Cartoon. News. Trailers for that. Now you get one picture for a bit.
Yeah. We've got two tracks left from your choice, Frank. We've got Singing the Blues, and we've got by Guy Mitchell. And we've got I Believe by Frankie Laine. Yeah. Which one would you like?
Guy Mitchell, because I saw him live in the Empire.
Oh, wow. So what?
I would say about 55, 56, I think.
Well, let's hear it. Singing the Blues. Let's hear Guy Mitchell.
Well, I never felt more like singing the blues, 'cause I never thought that I'd ever lose your love, dear. Why'd you do me this way? Well, I never felt more like crying. Everything's wrong and nothing ain't right without you. You got me singing the blues. The moon and stars no longer shine. The dream is gone I thought was mine. There's nothing left for me to do but cry over you. Well, I never felt more like running away. But why should I go? 'Cause I couldn't stay without you. You got me singing the blues. Well, I never felt more like singing the blues, 'cause I never
Guy Mitchell with Singing the Blues, which you saw at
Empire Theatre.
Very good.
We still done the British version. Seen Frankie Laine. He was a world Charleston champion in 1926. I read about it in a magazine. Blowing World, yeah.
Which is a great record. I mean, if you give him the right song.
That's correct.
Yeah, he really thumps it out.
That's correct.
And why, before we're running out of time, sadly, but why have you chosen I Believe?
Well, for one, it was banned in Britain at one time.
Right.
Because of the words.
Right.
You know.
Wow.
Which was a bit, looking back now, is it?
Yeah, doesn't seem much at all, does it?
No.
You saw him live, was he good?
He was good.
Yeah.
He was good.
He had something like a 60-year career in the charts, I think.
Right. No, he was really big time, Frankie Laine, yeah.
Mm. Thanks a lot, Frank. That's been absolutely brilliant.
My pleasure.
We're going to go out on Frankie Laine on good old 78, which I love the best. But once again, thanks to Frank. And it's from one Frank to the other. How about that? It's almost as if I knew what I was doing. Thanks a lot, Frank.
I believe for every drop of rain that falls, a flower grows. I believe that somewhere in the darkest night, a candle glows. I believe for everyone who goes astray, someone will come to show the way. I believe above the storm, the smallest prayer will still be heard. I believe that someone in the great somewhere hears every word. Every time I hear a newborn baby cry, or touch a leaf, or see the sky,